Doctors made a big mistake when they decided to pull the plug on this one-month-old baby. Sarah Rodriguez has been to hell and back. After having lost the love of her life to cancer, the mother of two found herself alone and in despair inside a hospital bathroom, praying that something could be done about her infant daughter's seemingly hopeless situation. Unfortunately, doctors decided it was time to pull the plug. And that is a decision they will most likely never forget, because what happened next was truly unbelievable. You do not want to miss this sad, but beautiful and miraculous story. It was 2005 when Sarah met Joel through a friend in New York City. Living in the Big Apple had always been Sarah's childhood dream, and she had just moved there to take a job as a receptionist. Joel, on the other hand, worked as an assistant for the Pontifical Mission Societies, a group of Catholic missionary societies that are under the jurisdiction of the Pope. They were smitten with each other after only one date and were married 6 months later. 1 year later, when they decided to start a family, they moved to Oklahoma to be near Sarah's parents, and there they bought their first home together. The future looked bright, but near that same time, Joel passed a blood clot in his urine and was sent to the hospital for tests. There, they found out that he had stage 3 kidney cancer that had eaten away his entire kidney. Luckily, chemotherapy sent Joel's cancer into remission, and the couple decided to continue trying to have children. We thought we would get pregnant right away, but 3.5 years later, we were still trying. Sarah recalls, "We were told that in vitro was our best bet, so we eventually decided to freeze some sperm." This decision would change their lives. To many, conceiving a baby may seem like an easy feat, but as many couples around the world will tell you, it does not come easy for everyone. Sarah and Joel had been struggling with infertility for over 3 years until they finally turned to in vitro fertilization, also called IVF. During this procedure, an egg is removed from the woman's ovaries and fertilized with sperm in a laboratory. The fertilized egg, called an embryo, is then returned to the woman's womb to grow and develop. It is an exhausting and expensive ordeal that tends to cost somewhere between $10,000 and $15,000. Converted in euros, that is around $8,200 and $12,300. Despite this hefty price tag, unfortunately, IVF treatment does not always work successfully. When an IVF cycle fails, many people feel grief, anger, and frustration. Sarah and Joel kept this in mind, and they tried to remain as realistic as possible. But their hopes were, of course, high. So when they were finally able to conceive through it, they were over the moon. They were expecting a little boy and could not wait to hold their son in their arms. But the birth of their son Milo was bittersweet. 3 days after their little boy came into the world, the couple learned that Joel was no longer in remission. But a few months before he died, Joel told his wife, "You are going to have another child, this time a little girl." He felt strongly that she would have a daughter someday to grow up with the son they had recently had. You see, when Joel was diagnosed with cancer, he froze his sperm as a precaution. Within days of his death, I thought about that conversation and knew there was this piece of him, two more embryos just down the street at an infertility clinic, Sarah recalls. I had this feeling in my heart that I should have another child and that there would be purpose to her life. She explained that the clinic Joel used refused to destroy embryos and that if she did not use his sperm, what was left of her husband would have gone to another family. Although she was now a single mother, Sarah made the difficult decision to try for another child and leave it in fate's hands. Eventually, Joel's prophecy came true, and Sarah gave birth to her baby girl, Ellis. "She was the beauty that came from the ashes of our story," says Sarah. "It felt like a part of Joel had returned to me with her birth." Things were starting to look up again, and Sarah was excited about their future as a family of three. But once again, fate had other plans in store for them. Just 2 weeks after her birth, Ellis's health deteriorated. Although she had seemed healthy when she had been taken home, Sarah noticed that her little girl had a high temperature. Alarmed, she rushed to the doctor, where she was told to take her immediately to the hospital. There, Ellis was diagnosed with bacterial meningitis, and she would spend the next 3 weeks in critical condition, clinging to life, unable to breathe on her own. It did not take long before doctors gave Sarah the devastating news that Ellis would soon pass away. "I remember seeing her scans one day, and my heart was filled with sadness, because Ellis's brain function was incompatible with life," Katie Tyler, a pediatric intensive care nurse recalls. There was no question that baby Alice would not even breathe, let alone eat and interact. With the extent of injury she had to her brain, and we knew it would be a very short time before she would pass away. Just a year and a half after having made the gut-wrenching decision to remove her husband from his ventilator, Sarah now found herself in the same position again, and she would have to make the same choice for her newborn. When it was obvious that nothing more could be done to save her little girl, she took her off the ventilator and took her in her arms, ready to say goodbye. It broke her heart. I was told there was no hope, so I made the decision to remove her from life support. She had stopped breathing along with her vent, so we just assumed, due to the damage of her brain, that she would pass away quickly, Sarah recalls. She placed her little girl on her chest and hoped that feeling and hearing each other's heartbeat would give the girl some peace. She also read her her first storybook and whispered in her ear, "You are so brave. It is okay to go now. You get to be with her daddy today." After the nurses removed her frail baby from the ventilator, Sarah soothed the little girl, expecting this moment to be their last. But as she drew Alice closer, something miraculous happened. As Sarah held Alice to her chest, she began to breathe on her own. Her seizures stopped, and tests a few hours afterwards showed no signs of meningitis or brain damage. She kept breathing, and she just cried, and all of her seizures, which the doctors could not even control with medication, stopped the moment I held her. It was like, once she was in my arms, she was home and she knew it. Suddenly, she was normal again. What a miracle! That is also how Sarah and even the doctors view it. There is no other way to describe it, and I cannot explain it any other way. This was a miracle, she says. I do not understand why it happened, but it did, and it restored my hope at a time when I most needed it. After Joel died, I did not know where I stood with miracles anymore, but now I know, wholeheartedly, that they exist. A lot has changed in Sarah's life since then. She has given up her life as a receptionist and oil company office worker to become a blogger and stay-at-home mom. Her family is the most important thing in her life. Although she still misses Joel dearly, she was recently remarried to her high school sweetheart, and she says that being his wife is her dream come to life. And by now, she is also a mom to 5 beautiful, healthy children. Sarah writes about her experiences in her popular blog, Journey of Sarah, and she has also published her own book called From Depth We Rise. Her blog is a great success, and she says it has been humbling to see the site grow to the point where it has reached millions of people in places she never knew existed. People have felt a heart connection to the space she created, and the community has been built. And for that, she is so grateful. The blog first began with the most devastating moment of her life, Joel's cancer diagnosis. That is the day the couple headed down a life-altering path, leaving them forever changed. She originally started the blog to share the latest medical news with their nearest and dearest, but it quickly turned into so much more. Sarah says that putting her thoughts onto paper became a sort of therapy for her, and over the years, she has faithfully chronicled all of the events of their lives, from their first fight against cancer, the birth of their son after years of infertility, and their daughter's miraculous recovery from bacterial meningitis. She admits that her life has been anything but normal, and adds that after Joel passed away, it was not the end of the story, but in many ways, it was the beginning. Today, Sarah no longer solely writes about the details of her journey, and also shares the beauty she sees in the world around her. She loves living life to the fullest, and her greatest hope is to inspire others to live life as an overcomer. Even amongst pain and grief, she fully desires to show that our best days are still yet to come. On the anniversary of Joel's passing, she also loves to spend the day doing random acts of kindness for strangers in honor of her late husband. Joel loved giving, so together, we are all turning pain into purpose, Sarah says. He was such a giving person, and this is a way for me to honor his life. And it is also very healing. I am raising our children without him, but Joel's memory brings me such joy. I know he would not want me to spend the day any other way. At the mere age of 33, Sarah lost her husband to cancer and almost lost her second child to meningitis. But luckily, things turned out differently. What about you? Do you believe in miracles? Have you ever witnessed one? Share your story in the comments. Who knows, maybe we will cover you in one of our upcoming videos. See you tomorrow in the next video.